post in 30 seconds. And life gets just a little bit better in only 20 seconds. Nine, eight, seven, six.
LoveLine is meant for an adult audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
Adam Carolla, Dr. Drew.
I'm not modeling anymore for the two of you.
LoveLine.
Yeah, it is LoveLine. It's nice. Someone took my mic cord and tied it in a goddamn knot. All right. Hey, that was you, Anderson? Why do you do that, Anderson? Okay. Phone number for Loveline, 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and addiction medicine specialist. Tonight, Nick Hexum is here from 311. There you go. Nick and his mates, the rest of 311, have themselves, let's see, who's the summer tour with? Incubus. And, oh, Jesus, Japan? Wow. We don't have any listeners who are currently in Japan, do we, Drew?
Not right, not at this moment.
So I'm not going to plug that too much, but I will give you some dates where... Nick, 311, and Incubus are going to be. Later on. And I guess I was telling Drew I haven't seen you guys in 4 years last night, but
then he
said 6 months, and I went, all right. Yeah, it sounds about it was right after the acoustic Christmas, right?
Yeah, I believe it was right around then.
All right. Do you remember what we talked about?
Yeah. I remember, you want a rundown?
Well, we're probably talking about the upcoming tour that you just finished, right?
I don't know. I think we got our dates a little mixed up, really. I mean, why would I have done it after the tour and after the...
No, it was the spring
right
tour. Yeah. Yeah, you were...
were talking about what was going to happen, but it has just been concluded.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Right. All right, we're off to kind of a rocky start here, Drew. But
I
think we're going to bounce back.
I blame you.
I blame me, too, yeah. Sound System's the name of the CD that's currently out, by the way, and we'll hear something off of that. We'll take some phone calls and play the rest by ear. What do you say? Mm. All right.
Sounds good to me.
John?
Hello?
You're 13?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just want to say that, like, you are awesome.
Me?
Yeah, you.
All right.
You're, like, the funniest man alive.
Well, that's true, yeah.
When I masturbate, or I guess jack off, I use shampoo as lubricant.
Yeah. You know the difference between masturbate and jack off?
I always thought masturbate meant, like, to play with it, and jack off was, like, you know, go up and down.
No,
you know what the difference between masturbation and jacking off is?
You never use the term jacking off after the age of about 15. That's
it is
the
I do, but it's the same difference as the difference between a sofa and a couch.
Yeah, right.
Which is nothing.
No difference, John.
There you go. All right, John, you use a shampoo.
Yeah.
And how many times have you heard me on the air warn kids about using shampoo for lubricant?
Ooh, there's a PSA in this.
There really is. Yeah, I hope you didn't use Prowl. I made that mistake once as a youth.
No, I don't even know what kind I use. I just kind of use it.
All right, so?
So, like, after I do this, about a few days after I use it, well, first of all, it starts to sting, and then, like, the skin just starts peeling off.
Yeah. Well, you got to use more. You're not using enough, obviously. But even though your penis is peeling, do you find that your pubic hair is healthy, bouncy, and manageable?
It, like, starts to itch.
Oh, I see. Starts to itch.
Yeah.
Okay.
Try cream rinse. Try the conditioner instead.
Yeah.
It's much...
Much smoother.
you're just causing a dermatitis.
It has
irritation.
Balsam and emollients. All right?
All right.
Yeah, it's not a big deal, but you could cause a sort of a burn, basically.
Hey, Nick? Just because we're not going to be there to watch over you in the future, you put the shampoo on your penis, you had some chafing, some burning, and some itching. Then you went right back to the well. That doesn't sound like a great plan. You know what I'm saying?
You're not following.
John?
Hello?
John, if you put...
So you said Nick.
Oh, I'm sorry. John, like, sorry, Nick.
I'm cool on that. Thanks,
yeah,
anyway.
You worked that out many years ago. But, John.
Yeah?
If you put something on your penis that burns it, don't put it on anymore. Okay?
All right.
Rest of your life. Now on.
You know those skateboarding helmets, John?
Yeah.
I like to see you wearing one all the time. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, you never play it too safe. You know, you go under the sink to get something, your mom calls you, you get up real quick, and you whack your head on a pipe or something. It can be very dangerous. All right. Charlotte.
Hi.
Hey, you're 16. What's up?
Hi. I wanted to say hi to Nick.
Hi.
Hi. I'm, like, so in love with you. I've been in love with you since, like, sixth grade. I was going through, like, serious depression, and my friend sold me your blue CD. And I love it. It inspired me. It, like, cheered me up. And I now play guitar. And I started my own band.
Awesome.
And you guys are, like, my big influence in life.
Thanks. Wow. I'm really, really glad to hear that. Are you feeling better these days?
Yes, I am. I'm very happy.
Okay. Wow,
but
good.
Not recently. I've had two boyfriends dump me because I wouldn't tell them I loved them because I loved you.
Oh. You don't actually love me like that. Like, you could love a boyfriend because we haven't met.
I know, but still, it's just... I don't know. It's a stupid infatuation or just...
That's really sweet, though.
It's not a stupid infatuation. It's okay to have infatuations, but to the extent that they sort of derail you from a real life, it can get in the way a little bit.
Yeah. Now,
well, you sound really young, right? How old are you?
16.
16.
Hey, listen, Charlotte.
Yeah.
I was talking about this last night. Just go ahead and say I love you. It's easy. I mean, you know, it's weird.
It's free.
It's really weird, though. Like, when you're younger, you go, you think, like, you have one, maybe two you can use up in a lifetime. Remember, it's like you're 19, you're with some chick, it's been 6 months, you're getting it on, you just finished, you're mopping off, and she's like, I love you, and you're like, oh. And it's like, hey, you're monogamous, you're with her, you guys are thinking about moving in. But what do? You don't say it. You screw yourself over. Someone should just say, hey, a-hole. You could say it twice in your life. You could say it 250 times. It doesn't matter. It's going to make it easier on you.
How much idealization of fantasy and people stick into those relationships. Like, well, the perfect one's going to come, and that's what I'm saving it for.
And maybe you're right, but just say you love them anyway. Yeah. Save yourself some hassle.
No, but Charlotte, on the other hand, that's pretty commendable that you were honest with them and, you know, didn't kind of bow down to the pressure.
And that's an interesting point. Sometimes these fantasy relationships with sort of media objects keep you out of relationships you're really not ready for.
Right. Oh, like Nick. That's right. Nick, the media object. Nick? Not yeah. That Nick. Caller Nick.
Yes, caller Nick.
I'm going to call you Nicholas.
All right.
All right, Nicholas, you're 20 years old. What's up?
Well, my girlfriend's got, like, vaginal, secretions that are coming out that smell. And, I mean, we've been together for 5 years.
Yeah, but it makes her easy to find, right?
Oh, yeah.
When, like, you're at the mall and stuff, you know.
Well, yeah, hey, but I mean.
Yep, I think she's in the B. Dalton. Yeah. And then the guy at the counter's going, oh, yeah, 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 she's back there. Yeah,
well,
she's.
It's beginning to be a problem, though. I mean, it's, and I'm afraid to, like, talk to her because I don't, you know. I don't want to embarrass her because, like, sometimes we'll wake up in the morning and, like, the bed will be kind of wet, and it's not, she didn't wet the bed. It's just that it's the secretions, and I just don't, you know, I don't know if I should, you know, confront her because I don't want her to feel embarrassed about it that, you know, I've.
Why confront? Why not just say, hey, I noticed this. Why not have a doctor check it out? It can be a sign of a vaginal infection.
Well, that's the thing is I'm worried, and I mean, if I'm, because, I mean, I have sex with her, and, you know, and I don't want to.
Why don't you take that caring perspective that you want to get this looked into? And maybe it's just her. Some women just do that.
Well, yeah, and see, I mean, I proposed to her like a week ago, and so, you know, I've.
This is a nice follow-up discussion.
Relationship. What's that?
Yeah. This is a nice follow-up discussion. Honey, what should we have for the flowers and photography? And
yeah, by the way, you're leaking. Your soul's coming out your vagina.
Yeah, and it smells, and I mean, it's the only time, you know.
Must have been rough. Like, did you get down on one knee when you proposed?
Yeah,
could have knocked you out.
In Fort Collins, in a restaurant, I proposed to her, you know, and no big deal. But, I mean, I just, right. I don't know if I should do something, you know, if I should just confront her, tell her, like, hey, go to a doctor, you know, you
yeah,
smell.
It's not going to be easy.
It's not going to be easy, but don't confront. Let her know that you are concerned.
Why not have an intervention?
Yeah.
Your crotch smells intervention.
Make sure you get her employer
faculty, like her old gym coach, English professor, people like that. People she knows, people she'd be embarrassed in front of.
Well, see, the thing is that, I mean, I've gone down on her before, and it doesn't smell then. You know, it doesn't.
Because you're in the eye of the hurricane. There's a certain calm. You know what I mean? It's like, I get the feeling, I think, tell me if I'm wrong here, Drew, but you know, you walk in when someone's crapped up the bathroom, you open the door, that's the worst place you're going to be. But if you actually stuff your head into the toilet, I don't believe it's as bad as when you just open the door. Now, I'm not suggesting you stuff your head into the toilet, but you know what I mean? Sometimes you can actually push past it and get to the other side of it.
It's just proof positive of the second law of thermodynamics.
There you go. Michelle?
Oh, hi.
Hey, you're 21.
Oh, my God. I can't believe. Kate, Nick, I love you. Oh, well, I don't. I mean, I love. Oh, I idol you. I envy you.
Thank you. That's really
you
sweet.
You are the sexiest man alive.
He is hot.
He is. You're embarrassing me. I just saw you.
Ow!
I just saw you play at Saltaire, and that was a way good
show. Salt Lake City.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
I had fun that night. Great that crowds there all the time.
Oh, my gosh. Okay. I can't believe I'm talking to you. Oh, this is incredible.
Well, we're really not talking. What do we want to talk about?
Okay, well, it just made me mad because I heard all this stuff about, you know, all those rumors about your name being KKK and just all that stuff. That just, I just thought you should get a chance to say out there that that's not true because.
That's a Nick, good idea.
Hold on, pull the hood off. She can't. It's getting in the way of the mic. Yeah.
No, that is a good point that we really are kind of, looking for opportunities to say how we feel about, that whole issue. And it's ironic that a band that has always been outspoken about, unity, from, different walks of life and being tolerant and being accepting would happen to be the band that gets, this racist rumor put on us. People think that our name stands for KKK. You know about this?
No.
Yeah, I've heard about this, yeah. And somebody did the math. It's some kind of math, but how's the math work?
It's, it's just that the 11th letter is K.
There,
so
that's
3-11, 3-K. So it was just a unfortunate coincidence. But, we take out to kind of let people know how we really feel about these things, we take out a representative from the Museum of Tolerance here in L.A.
Oh, I hate that place.
Why?
It's a little joke.
Oh.
It's the Museum of Tolerance, Drew.
Okay.
Well, I can't stand it.
No,
it's a really great organization, and he passes out literature and sells shirts and stuff just to raise awareness about being more accepting and what constitutes a bigot. And we try and do things in our career that make it so we're not just a business. We're doing things that make us feel like we're making a little bit of a difference.
What does 311 stand for?
It was the police code for indecent exposure in Omaha, where we grew up, and one of our friends got arrested for it and was brought home to his mom in handcuffs, naked. And that it was just a funny little story because the police code on the ticket, the number for the crime was 311. And
it also means Satan's minion. the Museum of Tolerance, that's the exit we get off.
Yes,
how I know when I'm... when I pass that, that's our exit. Every night I get off the 10 freeway right at the Museum of Tolerance. I keep meaning to go by there, but I can't keep figuring out what's in it for me. I mean, I'm sure I'd learn something, but it just doesn't sound fun. I want to go by that automotive. Is there an automotive Museum of Tolerance? I mean, if you could combine something that was exciting with something that was educational, I'd be there. That's the problem with museums. It's all education and no excitement. All right. Plus, I think it's like $8 to get in that place. It's not cheap for tolerance. All right, Shelley.
Yeah.
You're 18?
Yes, I am.
What's up?
Oh, first I want to say hi to Nick.
Hi there, Shelley.
You guys are great.
Thank you.
One thing I just want to let you know, what you probably do already know, is that you have brought a lot of people together from, like, all over the United States. I have friends in Ohio named Angela, and I have a friend of Mark in L.A., and... You guys have done great. I'd be very proud of yourself.
That's awesome. That's
and
really
even if
cool.
If you break up, you guys will live on forever.
Well, we're not breaking up, so. But thank you. Yeah, that's really nice to hear.
It's future advice.
Shelley, what's up? Speaking of breaking up, what's up with your line? Is that you?
My line?
Your phone line.
Yeah, it sounds a little crackly.
It could be. I'm on a cell phone.
All right. Well, hold on a second. Let me. Let's see if we can. I can read her question and put her on hold so we don't have to hear that. Best friend's boyfriend flirts with her. And touches her breasts. She wants to know how to tell the friend. Should she really tell the friend, or should she just sort of tell the guy,
I would never be alone with the guy. I'd tell the guy no in certain terms that she won't tolerate this, and that she would tell the friend. But I think the friend needs to be sort of put on notice by somebody what kind of guy she's dating.
All right, let me just see if that phone line's cleared up. Shelly?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, what do you mean he touches your breasts?
Okay, well, it's a long story, but to make a long story short, my friend was going out with him for about a year and a half, and one night we were all partying in my brother's room, and he
all right.
does flirt
so,
with me
yeah.
occasionally. And then at the end of the night, it came down, and she was gone, and somehow it ended up that I was on the bed with him, and all of a sudden his hand ended up my shirt, and I froze. I know you've heard this before. I froze. I didn't know how to get out of it, so thank God he had to go to the bathroom, and he was living in my house. He was my roommate.
What?
Yeah, he was my roommate.
Somehow
his hand
just wound up there. I mean,
exactly.
Were you guys like
wrestling?
You
guys wound up on the bed together, and then he had to take a leak, which is a weird...
code for something.
Yeah.
And what's worse is that my brother and him were sharing the same room, and my brother was, like, on the other bed. But the music was loud, so my brother couldn't hear.
Hear him put his hand up your top or hear him take a leak?
He put his hand up my shirt, and then, like, 2 minutes after that, he's like, I'll be right back, gotta go to the bathroom. I'm like, thank God. So and he went to the bathroom.
Was he just sitting there for 2 minutes with a...
No, he went in, did his stuff, and came right back out, and I met him at the door going back inside the house, and I said, I'm going to bed, I'm kind of tired, and he's like, okay, and he tried to kiss me, and I turned my cheek, and he kissed me on my cheek instead.
Did he go to the bathroom outside the house?
Ooh, good question. I don't know. I don't think so.
Oh, you said you met him at the door coming back in the house.
Yeah, because my brother...
All right, hey, Shelly?
Yeah?
Let me tell you something. Too many of you screwballs under one roof. It's a recipe for disaster. It really is. This happens all the time. You got the brother, you got the roommate, you got
what
the sister.
That? Yeah.
Well, listen, everybody. let me take just a second and talk to people who are poor, because I was poor my entire life. And I'm not talking about 19 or 20. I was piss poor till 30, 31. Now I'm a millionaire.
Literally.
True? Literally. Whatever. Literally a millionaire.
Whatever.
But the point is I was poor for a long time. And here's the thing about poor people. It's not that you don't have any money. It's you have a little bit of money. And you have to pick and choose where you spend that money. And let me give you a couple of tips. First and foremost, your phone. I always had a bunch of roommates, but I always had my own phone. And I was always piss poor. But for $12 a month, you get that Lifeline thing, it is the best thing you're ever going to do. It really is. I was always signing up for that loser discount. That hey, this guy hasn't quite finished high school discount they had. But really, you got to pay your own phone bill anyway. True. It's so rude of you to check your watch when I'm in the middle of a rant.
You see how this comes into play about the boob grabbing, right?
Yes, I'm going to get around to that. It is the same with your accommodations. Get a roommate. Get a girl you can trust. Move into a one-bedroom apartment. One of you sleeps on the fold-out sofa in the living room. The other one gets the bedroom. You switch off, whatever, $500 a month. You each pay $250. You can afford it. Believe me, don't live like animals with five serial rapists and some guy who calls himself your uncle in the same place while someone's cooking up meth in the garage because you save $27 a month. Meanwhile, the place is being raided by the SWAT team every other week. You know what I mean?
Yep.
You got... enough money, you can get your own ass together. All right. Thank you very much.
But in the short term, you got to just tell, if the guy's still hitting on you, then you just got to tell him what's up.
Yeah. And definitely don't roll around on the bed with him.
Yeah.
And furthermore, if I was a girl living in this situation, I'd put one of those barrel bolts on my door.
Barrel bolt and then draw that line down the middle of the room, too. Oh. Make sure.
Yeah, like the sitcoms from the 70s. No, I'd put a lock on my bedroom door because this guy could come home loaded one night and stumble right on in. And if you're going to freeze when he touches you, God knows what he's going to do to you before you unfreeze. I wish more women would freeze when I touch them. They have no problem. They don't freeze at all. They're like, hey, get away. Yeah, they kick. Chris?
Yeah?
You're 15.
Yep.
What's up?
First I want to say I can fart on command.
Really?
Yeah.
Who's command?
Anyone.
Oh, I see.
So fart.
Okay, hold on.
All right. Apparently, I heard something in the distance.
He's one of those.
Yeah.
You get that?
Oh, yes. Did we hear it? The neighbors heard it.
The nation heard it. What are you talking about?
God heard it. Your dead grandmother heard that
fart
one.
Fart heard around the world.
That's right. Hey, Chris, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't know how many people had this gift until I got onto the show.
Your parents must be proud.
I can do the same thing with my burps.
Well, that's a layup, but the gas common. Is what I'm most interested in.
Okay.
That's very nice. All right, you have something else for us?
Yeah, I got a question.
All right.
Does masturbating make my penis get bigger?
Ask it in the form of a fart, please.
No. No, it doesn't.
No, it does not. I wouldn't have been able to make it into this studio if that was true.
Okay.
I'm 35. I have 20 years under my belt, pardon the pun, and I can tell you, as a matter of fact, I think I've eroded my penis. I think it's smaller than it would have been.
Sharpened it.
I'm convinced. Yeah, well, I mean, like anything in nature, glaciers, streams
wears cutting, down eventually.
Cutting,
yeah,
cutting canyons. I mean, eventually, that kind of constant friction will wear something down. I mean, even granite gets worn down.
It gets smoother and rounded. Were you pointy and?
I was jagged.
Jagged to start with, yeah.
Yeah, I had to wear a gardening glove for my first couple of years because my penis was so sharp. It had a lot of shards and barbs on it and whatnot. All right, Sean.
When we get back.
Oh, Sean, when we get back?
Yeah.
All right. His penis popped during sex.
Popped?
Felt like he was cracking a knuckle.
Oh, I see.
I know that. Yeah. I've done that. Yeah. I used to be able to do that.
All right.
All right. Nick Hexum is here from 311. We're going to hear something from 311. We'll also speak to Sean with his amazing popping penis after this.
Loveline. 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 We'll be right back.
Visit the Army Reserve Job Bank at GoArmyReserve.com and hear about jobs in medicine, aviation, or telecommunications. The Army Reserve Job Bank has many jobs in your area. Just plug in your zip code and you'll find listings for everything from PCs to MPs. Serve as little as 1 weekend a month, 2 weeks a year. Learn skills that can help in college or a career. Sound good? It is. Visit the Army Reserve Job Bank at GoArmyReserve.com. Paid for by the U.S. Army Reserve.
To make this commercial more believable, I'm joined today by several real, I stress real, GEICO Auto Insurance customers. Warren Foster, Karen Ellis, and Robin Kaspar. I wish we had time to talk, but this is a 30-second radio commercial. So, people, if you saved money with GEICO, just nod your heads. And they're nodding. You could join the millions who nod, too. In 15 minutes, you could save 15% or more. Call 1-800-947-AUTO. 1-800-947-AUTO. GEICO Direct, the sensible alternative.
Hi, I'm Serenity, and these are my friends, Missy and Stephanie.
You know, a lot of things happen to us every day that we have no control over.
But HIV and other sexually transmitted diseases aren't things that just happen to you. You do have a choice.
You can choose to use a condom, have safe sex, and take control of your life.
Asking for a condom isn't stupid. It's smart. It shows that you care about yourself and your partner.
You can do something about sexually transmitted diseases.
Use a condom.
Every partner.
Every time.
We do.
A message brought to you by Wicked Pictures and AIDS Project Los Angeles.
Oh, come on. Have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken? Everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool. Join the crowd. Have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go. She's no fun.
Make the right choice. Don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Somewhere in our community is a mother whose drug abuse once left her unable to care for her kids. There's a father, too, whose alcohol use drove his wife and children away. There's a boyfriend whose drug use frightened his girlfriend into giving him an ultimatum: get help or I'm gone. Help is available. It's in the form of treatment programs for drug abuse and alcohol problems. And the good news is that these programs are making a big difference in people's lives. With proper treatment, mothers and fathers, sweethearts and co-workers, friends and neighbors are overcoming drug and alcohol problems and reclaiming their lives. Isn't it great that treatment works? To find out about drug and alcohol treatment programs that can help, call 1-800-662-HELP. That's 1-800-662-HELP. There is help. and it works. A public service of this station and the Center for Substance Abuse Treatment.
Dad, I don't think our campfire's totally out.
Are you kidding me? I know when a campfire's out.
Did you drown the fire with water and stir it with a stick?
No, it's out. We don't have to... Who said that?
Frank, it's a talking moose with sunglasses.
And a bunch of singing and dancing forest animals.
We know we can count on you to do what Smokey says.
And when your folks desire to build a fire.
Hot.
Clear brush and branches away. And keep water nearby like you oughta.
Okay, I poured water on the fire. I stirred it with a stick. Everybody walked slowly toward the RV.
Dad, these are just Smokey's friends.
Only you can prevent forest fires.
Frank, it's Smokey.
Nice hat, Smokey. Want the rest of my peanut butter sandwich?
Dad!
Visit Smokey at www.smokeybear.com. Brought to you by the USDA Forest Service, the National Association of State Foresters, and the Ad Council.
Yep, it is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. He is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. We don't need the facts. Nick Hexum is here from 311. Sound Systems, the name of the CD. We're going to hear something off of that CD. I think we'll hear something called the Flowing. But I think what we're going to do is we're going to speak to Sean first, and then we'll hear some 311. Sean?
Yeah.
You're 21?
Yeah.
Your penis popped, huh?
Yeah, it was weird. It was really weird.
Whenever somebody says that, I'm always hoping they don't mean exploded.
No, it's like cracking my knuckles almost. But
well, that's a normal thing. There's a ligament there that can pop, that can crack just like a knuckle.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's
the only time it's ever happened, it's never happened again.
Was it when you kind of missed and you kind of jammed it or like...
No, it's more of a pushing down thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I can miss. I mean, the same thing. But yeah, here's the deal. Well, let's say my feet are... you got to go down like that and it'll pop eventually. You got to have a good erection. You got to have a good one. You know what I mean?
As opposed to the naughty ones.
Well, no, the balls know who's been naughty and who's been nice. Yeah. As the song goes, here's how it works. I used to be able to do this. I can't do it anymore. I think it has sort of combined with me losing the will to live, but I'm not sure if it has anything to do with it or not. But if you fall asleep all night with an erection and you're young and you know you have that erection going all night and you wake up the next morning, that is prime popping hour. You push it down and it'll pop. Lift it up, go right to left, nothing but down. And it'll get to the point where it's starting to hurt a little, and then you push it just another quarter inch, crack.
Oh, it sounds terrible.
Really, it's not bad. You ought to try it.
Let's talk to Noelle before we go to the song.
She
has a question about the song.
Okay. Noelle?
Hi.
What's up?
I want to say quickly, Adam, Drew, I love you guys, longtime listener.
Thanks.
And Nick, longtime listener as well.
Cool.
And
thank you.
Anyways, I just wanted to say, first of all, my first question, I have two questions, if that's okay, please.
All right, hurry.
Okay. First question is, Flowing, what's that about? And the other question is, well, it's not really a question, just a comment. We went to see you in the Palladium on Monday. You guys were great. And I just wanted to let you know, like, when you were leaving and people were mobbing you, we thought that was wrong. We were the people screaming, leave him alone. So just thought I'd let you know that, too. So, again, I'll go back to my first question, Flowing. Wanted to know what that video was about, or about that song, actually. I don't really care about the video, but the song.
Well, the video and the topic of the lyrics don't really connect.
That's what I figured.
Exactly. It was more the video is Marco Siega, the video director's interpretation. And the song, because the video is about, when you fall asleep all over the place just for no reason.
Narcolepsy.
Yes, thank you. I just had a blank there, but anyway, the song is about insomnia, which you know, is something that I was going through at the time of writing that, where I would get to sleep at like fairly early. I'm more of like a morning person. I would get to sleep at like 11 at night, and then I would wake up at 3, and that was it. And so it was just kind of about the feeling of of you know, trying to get back to sleep and feeling pretty alone when you're going through that. And so I would just kind of get up and go to the studio at 3 a.m. and make music. And it's you know, there was other things going on in my life at that time that were kind of probably contributing to my, what I call my mind spins, where I just cannot, you know, relax. And so it hasn't been a problem lately, but that's what it's about.
Oh, cool. Thank you.
And thanks for, you know, trying to get him to leave me alone. It was hell. It was like people were screaming at me from every direction.
Were you driving your own car?
Yeah.
And they spotted you?
Yeah.
And, yeah.
It was just like 100 people around me trying to take pictures. And
yeah, you don't want to run them over. But that's in the first
window.
That's in the first 5 minutes. after that, you get over it pretty quick. I told you we were in Santa Barbara doing something a few months ago. Well, we did our lecture in Santa Barbara.
Yeah.
And after that, me and Jimmy went to some like frat party in a van. And we got mobbed in some street. And it was just a bunch of drunk frat guys and people. And it's just sort of mob mentality, which is half the people didn't even know who we were or didn't care. But since everyone else did, they just piled on. And they were like rocking the van and banging on the window. And for the first like 5 minutes, I was telling the driver, "Ooh, easy, easy," because it's a sort of a
watch for toes.
There's a lot of human beings in front of the van. But about 5 minutes into, I was like, "Hey, punch it, just take out some of these pukes." Hey, we got to teach them a lesson. And this is Darwinism, by the way. If you're going to stand in front of a 4,000-pound van and bang on the windshield and try to antagonize the guy who's high and has his foot on the accelerator, and you get taken out, that's all right with me. We don't need to see what your kids are going to turn out to be. All right, so this is 311, and this is the song we're talking about, Flowing.
Along the way to close my eyes, I lost where I was going.
Yellow.
Crowd goes nuts. The studio audience.
That is 311. That is off of Sound System. Nick Hexum is our guest tonight. Had an interesting conversation today, Drew. You know how I hate publicists?
Oh, yeah.
Daniel and Jimmy decided we needed a publicist for the man show. And, you know, I hate the publicist, but I understand they do things. And the reason I understand they do things is it's year number four that I have not been asked to do the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, even though every year we have their drivers in here. And every year I tell the Grand Prix people I want to drive one of those goddamn Toyotas. Yep. And every year they never call me.
So this is the threshold question for whom you're going to choose as a publicist.
Well,
can you get Adam on the Toyota Grand Prix?
Forget about
Give me
doing
a race car.
Forget about doing the Kilbourne show or something. I want to get in some kind of celebrity softball game. Yeah. I want to destroy a Celica. So we're talking to the guy back and forth. I don't want to mention his name. He's a decent guy.
Not a guy you've badmouthed repeatedly.
I may have. I don't know. I've badmouthed all publicists. So there's two things. So I said, well, you know, how much is it? And he said, well, it's about, you know, I'll do the both of you. One person is like $2,500 a month, and, you know, both people, it's like $3,000 a month. And I said, okay, but you do realize that for $3,000 a month, we could both be driving fully insured Lamborghini Countaches every day and gas and insurance, the whole thing. I mean, the choice is do the Kilbourne show once every 3 months or drive a fully loaded Countach. Paid for. You know what I mean? And probably have a few bucks left over at the end of the $3,000. So I told him that, and he laughed and said it was still $3,000. And here's what I said to him, though. And this is the logic, and I'd like all publicists to listen to me on this one. I have two TV shows and a radio show, and Jimmy's doing fine and all that kind of stuff. We don't need a publicist. What we need you to do is stop representing other people. Because if the playing field is level, we're in. I'm doing that goddamn Toyota Grand Prix every year over Anthony Michael Hall if neither one of us has a publicist. You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
So here's what I'd like publicists to do. Stop representing everyone. That's the thing. I now have to have a publicist because a-holes have publicists. Right. And I have to get one just to break even.
Right. That's right.
I mean, seriously, I don't want to reach down and blow myself here, but I got
I'm
a
funny.
Couple of TV shows
here it goes.
And a
here
radio
goes.
Show.
I'm
no, I got
funny over here.
I have a lot more going on career-wise right now than a lot of the people who would be at the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach.
Yes.
Maybe even most of them. Not all of them, but if you took the 20 of them, I might be ahead of 10 of them. Maybe more.
You got Anthony Michael Hall beat.
I ain't doing it, and the reason I ain't doing it is because I don't have a publicist, and now I have to get one because everyone else has one so I can break even.
Yes.
What a scam, by the way.
Just levels the playing field, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, think about it. Think about the TV shows, the interviews, the whole thing. If everything was just equal, everything was level, you ever wonder why you see certain people over and over and over again, people you don't care about that much? Yasmin Bleef is everywhere, and she's on the world's crampiest dog of a show. I see that that show she's on with Cheech and Don Johnson. Oh my God, that thing's like it's really just a crap-filled Zeppelin. That show going Zeppelin. Into a mountainside, really is Nash Bridges. You know what I mean? You see that show? It's ridiculous.
Never seen it.
All right. I'm done.
Didn't we have Cheech on the TV show?
I'm sure. They're all very talented. It's just the show is a ridiculous show. He's an undercover cop and drives a canary yellow 71 Barracuda around town burning rubber everywhere. And he wears like a loud plaid Doc Severinsen type sport coat. It's a ridiculous show. The point is why do I have to spend $3,000 a month on a publicist now because everyone else has one? If you pussies would all drop your publicist and be mad about this, let the shows who want you take you. Let the magazines that want to speak to you talk to you. Let the events like the Toyota Grand Prix or celebrity baseball games, let them contact you if they want you, pussies.
It's like let the market prevail, huh?
Let the market prevail. Yeah. Publicists. Ugh.
Ugh.
What a racket.
You got that, kids?
Joe?
You got
what
that, kids?
What a racket.
Yeah.
Jesus
I'm
speaking
to the youth of America. Yeah, very interested in this stuff, Adam. Joe.
Ugh.
Hello?
All right.
Yeah, what's going on?
I wanted to know how you guys feel about going on tour with Incubus again.
It's Renee.
Incubus is a really exciting group right now, and it's just like blowing me away with their record and their live shows. I mean, really, I just think that you know, they're really original and innovative, and Brandon's a really great singer, and we're really excited about it. They're good guys. I was hanging out with them last night, and looking forward to that, no question.
And they have a publicist.
No doubt.
That's how they got.
No, we're going to break.
Oh, we are?
Yeah.
Let me say hi to June. What are you worried about, Drew? Don't worry, I'll do the driving here. June, you're 22.
Yes, I am.
I just wanted
to say, first of all, you guys are a riot. You crack me up, and both of you are sexy.
Me and Drew, or Nick
both
and Drew?
Both you and Drew.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's right. All right. All right, so what do you want?
I was actually wondering, ever since I was a little girl, I had this fear of being molested. It's not so much anymore, but when I was a little girl, I had this fear.
How did you find out about what that even was?
That's a good question. I don't know.
All right, well, hold on. That's a good place to take a break.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Drew, let's make some popcorn.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's always good radio. Nick is here
crunch,
of 3
crunch.
Of 11.
I'm going.
Yeah, and
I'm
we'll
going.
Be we'll be back after this.
We'll be right back with more.
LoveLine.
How was school today, Rebecca?
We learned what the Earth was like a long time ago, way back in the 1990s.
Oh.
Grandpa, did you ever taste water?
Oh, my, no. By the time I was a boy, water, if you could find it, was pretty much unfit to drink. But I hear tell, long ago, children used to make lemonade with actual tap water and drink it on hot, sunny days.
Really?
Yeah, and sometimes they'd fill balloons with water and toss them at each other and laugh or run through the sprinkler singing and carrying on. And then after a day of playing, their folks would put them in a tub, fill it with water and bubbles and scrub them until they were squeaky clean.
Wow. Why didn't people try to save the water?
Well, I guess they didn't think one person could make a difference.
Thousands of Americans make a difference every day. For example, over 900 million tons of untreated sewage is no longer discharged into our nation's waters. A message from ECHO, the Earth Communications Office.
He's the... We're gonna try to get some more
okay,
stuff.
Class. This part of the museum is known as the Hall of Trees.
What's a tree?
Large plants that once covered much of the Earth. This is a full-scale model of a maple tree.
Wow.
What are those green things?
Those were called leaves. They took in sunlight, nourished the tree, expelled oxygen, creating air for people to breathe.
People didn't breathe out of air tanks?
No, then air was everywhere. The sky was blue, even the ocean was blue.
The ocean was blue?
And filled with fish.
What's a fish?
When you protect the Earth, you protect your health and that of your children. We're making progress. There has been a significant improvement. 20 years ago, air pollution in Los Angeles exceeded health standards on 4 out of every 5 days. But we still have a long way to go.
Here's the Hall of Weather. Press that button and you'll hear a rainfall.
Why'd they need rain?
Without rain, a flower couldn't grow.
What's a flower?
One person can make a difference. A message from ECHO, the Earth Communications Office.
Personally, I'm so sick of hearing about the environment.
I know. What's everyone so worried about?
51 million Americans live in areas where the air is officially classified as unhealthy to breathe.
It's a big world, and it's been here a long time.
Yeah, we're talking years and years and years.
The Center for Disease Control says that 94,000 people get sick every year from contaminated water. 900 of those people die.
It's all in their heads.
It's media hype.
The average American dumps at least 20 pounds of household toxins down the drain every year, most of which ends up in the drinking water supply.
Personally, I drink tap water. I mean, it's not like we're in Bangladesh.
Personally, I feel fine. I mean, I ask you, seriously, who's really getting hurt here?
5.8 million children died last year as a result of unsafe drinking water.
Not me, or my kids, right, Billy? Billy, where are you?
Can one person make a difference? Today, 66% of our rivers and lakes are safe for fishing and swimming, a third more than in 1970. One person can make a difference. A message from ECHO, the Earth Communications Office.
And now, Vince and Larry, the crash test dummies with a lullaby.
Crumple, crumple, little car, when you crash, it's au revoir.
If on dumb luck you rely, through the windshield they will fly.
Keep your children off the streets.
Put your kids in safety seats.
Crumple, crumple, little car. Don't be dummies like we are.
Gee, Vince, I'm kind of sleepy now.
Okay, Larry, just crash anywhere.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids' safety belts. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken, everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool, join the crowd, have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go, she's no fun.
Make the right choice, don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Yeah, it is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Nick Hexum is here from 311 tonight. Drew, seriously, can we go online somehow?
You want me to? I'll look
can you do that?
Yeah.
Yeah, go find out who's running that Toyota Grand Prix.
You want me? I get my computer set up right here.
Really?
Yeah.
And plug it into something?
I've got it wireless access. Don't plug it
oh,
in.
Oh, you do?
Yes.
What is that?
Oh, yeah.
You have wire? That's the devil's computer.
I got that, too. It's awesome. But it's kind of slow still.
Not too bad. I got it really pretty fast.
How do you do what? How do you?
You but,
I don't understand how you access
it's
something.
It's on a cellular. It's like a cellular system.
Wow. Yeah. True. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's
all right.
Well,
during the commercial, right. Go get that. Right. That is sweet, buddy. June?
Yes.
You're 22.
I am.
Will that work on? It won't work on an airplane, will it?
Huh?
Yeah, I tried it a couple times and it didn't, but it might.
Might crash the plane.
Yeah. I'm always afraid I'm gonna do something weird to
it. Yeah, you know what I love about the plane? Your cell phone will crash a plane. Their cell phone, which costs $19 a minute, is perfectly fine.
Yeah.
No problems there. Yeah, I'd be curious to do the math on that one. Yeah. All right, June, what's up, sweetie?
Well, you guys asked me where I got the term molesting.
Yeah.
At such a young age.
At such a young age? I don't know. Maybe from TV or maybe from school.
Mm-hmm.
I suspect one of your parents was obsessed about this or anxious about it, and you picked it up.
You don't think you were molested, though?
I don't know.
Yeah, well, if you don't know, who cares?
I would bet mom had some brushes, some near misses, and then freaked out about it. Is that true?
I don't know.
And then that was sort of transmitted to you via her anxiety.
When fears like that are often like passed down, wouldn't you say?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Whether it's fear of heights or whatever.
All right, June, don't worry about it.
Okay.
You doing okay now?
Yeah.
That's the verdict. Right. Don't worry about it.
Okay.
No, but listen, I don't know if I have been reincarnated. I don't know if my uncle put his thumb up my ass when I was 6 months old. I don't know any of that stuff. And you know what? Because I don't know it, don't care. It's not making a difference.
At this point.
Yeah. Now, if I saw my uncle and started crying uncontrollably, then I might think, all right.
Your relationships have all been such a success.
Oh, true.
Ouch.
Yeah. Isn't that part of your Hippocratic oath not to make fun of people?
The biggest vulnerability.
T? No, yes. He's jealous. You're 21.
Yes.
That Peter the Fool calls this show. Okay. What's up there, T?
I don't know. I would like your opinion on something.
All right. Well, hurry up, Quaalude girl.
Well, I got myself in a predicament that's way over my head now. I'm sleeping with a friend of mine. When we began this, I told him that I didn't want to get emotionally involved. And there was no strings attached because I was dating my ideal guy.
You were dating your ideal guy at the time?
But started sleeping with somebody else?
Yeah.
Mm.
Well, it didn't begin that way. What my friend was for was to help me explore my sexuality because I had a fear of intimacy.
I see. Well, that was good of him to do.
See, this is totally nuts.
Yeah. What a
I'm gonna
nice
start.
Guy.
We'll start the exploration process by you blowing me.
Yes.
you don't mind if I crack a beer? It helps me think.
It's a favor to you to help you get over your.
Yeah, it's only been 20 minutes. I don't think you've quite discovered your sexuality yet. Get back down there. That's nice. I love guys.
Well,
who says chivalry is dead, by the way? You hear fine examples like this. Young man willing to take time out of his busy day to help you explore your sexuality.
Yeah, I...
Oh, Jesus Christ. We got two things of popcorn coming in. Okay, nobody touch these until the commercial. Come on. All right. T?
Yes?
What happened to you? Did something happen to you when you were growing up?
What do you mean?
Did anyone
sexually abused?
Help you explore your sexuality when you didn't want them to?
No. I have a fear of intimacy. And
why?
Where'd that come from? Where'd that come from?
I don't know.
Okay.
But
well, let's move on. I just feel like it's going to be a real long night with T. I really do. I feel bad. Right, one more time. T.
Yes.
Where's your dad? Real fast.
My dad's here.
And he never did anything bad to you?
No. My dad's great.
Mom?
My dad.
What'd your mom do?
My mom is great.
Okay. They're both great.
Yeah.
And nobody's hit you or cursed at you or molested you or raped you or did anything like that to you?
When I was growing up, yes, I was molested.
Didn't we just ask that explicitly 5 minutes ago?
Yes. Yeah. Who molested you?
Somebody in my family.
Who?
No. I'm done. Yeah. I'm done. Sorry, yeah. T. T, don't call the goddamn show if you don't want to talk. I'm not going to squeeze you like a effing bar rag to try to get information out of you. I'm sorry for what's happened to you. I'm sorry what's happened to all of you, but the show's about me. No, the show's about me trying to get a publicist. No, you have to call the show, and if we ask you if you're molested and you don't come forth with it, and then you tell us a whole bunch of ass that makes us think you were molested, so we ask you again, and then you begrudgingly admit it, and then you say somebody molested you, and I say who, and you say someone in the family, so I have to then guess again. I'm not going to play along with that passive-aggressive BS.
You're fired.
Go ahead.
You're fired.
You're having difficulty in your intimacy? Good. Rotten intimacy, hell. Don't bother me anymore.
It's hard for her, poor
Jesus
T.
Christ.
She's 21.
She's 21 years old. Get some therapy. Mike, you're 15.
Yeah, hello.
Hey, buddy, what's going on?
Mike, what's up?
A couple of days.
Oh, Drew with the popcorn. I knew I couldn't do it. All right, Mike, what's up there?
A couple of days ago, I did some crank and... I don't know, I was having sex with a girl, and I thought my penis grew bigger. I don't know. It might have been just in my head.
It was in your head.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
All right. Well, what do you want Drew to say?
I don't know. I was hoping it was true.
Oh, boy. Hey, Mike?
Yes?
Don't make me give my speech about stupid people shouldn't do drugs because they're already dumb. And it makes them even dumber. That's an embarrassing speech. Don't do any more drugs, you idiot.
I thought you were going to give me the why do you call the show.
No, I'm done with that. That's the next caller. Hey, Mike? Mike, listen to me.
Huh?
If you stopped doing drugs right now, started doing push-ups and eating nothing but stream water, bananas, and herbs, you'd still have a hard time getting a job when you're 18. Do you understand? As it is, it's going to be impossible. You're going from difficult to impossible.
Asshole.
You might as well just cut your arms off. Now stop effing with your brain, you numbskull. You understand me? You're going from dumb to retard.
Well, pot's his main drug.
Oh, man. Listen, I've said it a million times, I'll say it again. If you're a genius and you want to smoke some weed and do some X or whatever the hell you want to do, go ahead and do it. I don't care if your IQ goes from 165 down to 125. You're still smarter than most people that call this show. But if your IQ is starting out at 86 and you think you're going to knock it down to 55, you're going from barely able to get a job to flat out Meals on Wheels candidate. And that's what our listeners do, and they don't know it. It's like, I hate to say it, but it's like, hey, buddy, you're stupid anyway. Now you're going to tard land. No one will say that. Nobody else will say that, but it's the goddamn truth. It really is. If you're a smart guy and you want to smoke a little weed or do a little acid, God bless you. I don't care if you go from super genius down to genius. mad scientist down to super genius.
AMA is this the view of the medical associations of the world.
They'll never talk about it. It's always no one do drugs. Hey, if you're a genius and you want to smoke a little pot, fine. Hey, if you're average intelligence, you want to smoke a little pot and do a little X, whatever, fine. But if you're below average, I mean, if you're one of the guys from Deliverance and you want to get stoned all the time, you're not going to be able to get a job.
The problem is it's not all about cognition. It's also about affect, mood, and emotional life. So.
All right. We got to eat some popcorn.
Yes.
Drew, you got to go get your computer.
I know.
So I'm fired up tonight. All right. We'll take a little break. Nick Hexum is here from 311. We'll be back after this.
We'll be right back with more.
LoveLine.
Remember what college cost in the early 80s?
Tuition?
Yeah, books, typewriter, room and board.
Well, yeah, a bundle.
Was it worth it?
Well, of course, every penny.
And get this, now it's over twice what you paid.
Well, yeah, but I don't have to worry about my kids' college bills for another 15 years.
Well, if costs keep hiking up and up, you'll be shelling out more in just 1 year for each of your children than you spent on yourself for all 4 years of college.
Ouch! So what do I do?
You better start saving today with U.S. Savings Bonds. They're easy to buy and afford and are guaranteed safe.
Yeah?
And savings bonds earn a treasury-based rate of interest right from the start.
Wow. Where do I find them?
At most banks. Or ask your employer about the payroll savings plan. But whatever you do, start saving now or you'll be...
rooting for a scholarship?
Exactly.
Mommy, can I have a drink of water?
Remember the last time you changed your motor oil? You let it flow down a storm drain. It found its way into our waters. So did that paint you tossed in the garbage, as well as those fertilizers you might have used a few too many of. If you think your actions have no effect on our waters, think again.
Thank you, Mommy.
You can help preserve our waters, not only for your sake, but for hers. Recycle used motor oil. Dispose of paint and household toxins properly. Practice composting and use lawn and garden products sensibly. It's a small price to pay to preserve our greatest natural resource, and the reasons for doing so can be just as small.
Good night, Mommy.
Clean water. If we all do a little, we can do a lot. To find out how to help reclaim our waters, call 1-800-504-8484. That's 1-800-504-8484. Brought to you by the Natural Resources Defense Council, the Ad Council, and the EPA.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken, everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool, join the crowd, have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go, she's no fun.
Make the right choice, don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
And now, Vince and Larry, the crash test dummies with a lullaby.
Crumple, crumple, little car, when you crash, it's au revoir.
If on dumb luck you rely, through the windshield they will fly.
Keep your children off the streets.
Put your kids in safety seats.
Crumple, crumple, little car, don't be dummies like we are.
Gee, Vince, I'm kind of sleepy now.
Okay, Larry, just crash anywhere.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids' safety belts. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
McGruff here at the airport with some tips that can help make your traveling safer. Pardon me, sir.
Hmm? Hey, aren't you...
McGruff, the crime dog.
Yeah, I thought I recognized the pause.
Where do you keep your wallet?
My hip pocket.
Well, look over there at that man at the ticket counter.
So?
The guy behind him in line just bumped him.
Yeah?
And he could have picked his pocket while the man was talking to the ticket agent, just like someone could have picked yours while you were looking over there.
Oh, gosh.
Put your wallet in your front pants pocket or your briefcase.
Oh, yeah, really, sure.
Another thing, hold on to that laptop computer all the time. Don't put it down. It's too easy for someone to pick it up when you turn your head.
Oh, hey, you know, you're just full of... good advice. Thanks, McGruff.
You're welcome. Just remember, keep your wallet in a safe place. Never leave your bags or valuables unattended, even for a minute.
No.
Do that and you'll be helping
take a bite out of crime.
You got it. A public service message from me, McGruff, the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
Dad, can you and can me and Olivia and you take me to the zoo?
Kids need dads when they're babies.
Daddy, can I tell you a secret? I think there is a monster under my bed.
When they're little, when they're teens, when they're young adults.
Dad, all my...
Sadly, most kids don't have a dad to rely on.
Dad, I met the most amazing person the other day, and I was just wondering, how did you know that Mom was the one?
Because most dads spend less than 10 minutes a day with their kids.
Dad, should I invest in a CD or a mutual fund? And what do you think?
Being a dad is real simple. All it takes is time. And it takes a man to be a dad. Call 1-800-790-DADS for free, helpful information. A message from the National Fatherhood Initiative and the Ad Council.
Yeah, it's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Nick Hexum's our guest tonight from 311. Sound Systems, the name of the CD. I'm all fired up tonight. I don't know what the hell's going on. It was at 8:30 tonight. I was sitting at the man show. I was going to vomit and throw and then go to bed. That was my plan. I just wanted to go to bed. I was had my headache. I was tired. I was whipped from the week. I got home, I beat the crap out of that heavy bag, and I came in here all fired up.
You really do that?
Yeah, I got a good heavy bag. Ooh, ooh,
ooh. Working the heavy bag.
Oh, yeah, yell at it. Hey, come on!
Can we do the 10-second thing?
Oh, yeah, mm-hmm. We got to do that thing. See, I'm so fired up, I missed that thing. All right, we're going to take a quick 10-second timeout. We'll be back with more of the Fabulous Program in just 10 seconds.
This is Loveline on
Radio
Station.
Yeah, all right. Now we're back. I'm still fired up. You guys are lucky I got a mouthful of popcorn. I can't yell. Drew?
Yep.
You can find me who's on that Toyota Grand Prix, would you? Drew's got the computer out. Sharon?
Yeah.
You're 22. What's up?
About 2 months ago, my boyfriend mentioned that he wanted anal sex, and I'd sort of noticed that that's what he'd wanted by how he was acting in bed. And as soon as he mentioned it, I told him no, and I can't get it out of my mind.
What can't you get out of your mind?
The idea of him doing that, and while we're involved, that's all I can think of, really.
Trianal rape.
He wants to do that, you know?
Yeah, I know he wants to, but you said no.
Yeah.
And you don't think he's going to listen to that?
No, I don't think he's... I was waiting for him to bring it up again, and he did, and I knew that he would, and he hasn't brought it up since that point.
All right. What is your question?
Something you want to do?
It's not, but I feel really, I feel bad.
Why?
Because it's something that he wants to explore, and it's just something that I don't want to do.
Well,
nothing
listen.
Nothing wrong with that.
Him exploring Judaism or Christianity is one thing, but him exploring your anus... is a different situation because it's attached to you.
Yeah.
It's right next to your ass.
But I plan to be with him for a long time, and he's going to be wanting to explore it, you know?
Oh, don't be ridiculous. Oh, come on.
Christ.
Come on.
Where are these women? Where's your sister? I want to date her. Or your mom.
It's not something that he's going to get over, I imagine. He's always going to want to explore
it. He's already dropped it. He's already dropped it.
You don't know that.
Didn't you just tell us that?
He just said he brought it up one other time, and that was it.
And I made it clear that I didn't want for him. So he dropped it, but that doesn't mean that it's off of his mind.
Well, I'm guessing he sodomizes the neighbor's kid because he's got to check it off the list. I mean, once a penis gets a taste of anus, that's it.
Okay, you know, if that's what I'm going to believe, then maybe he should be gone. Is that what you're telling me?
Yep. You better break up.
He's thinking of sodomizing some neighbor kid.
Well, maybe not the kid, but possibly the dog or the grandmother. Yes,
okay,
certainly.
So you're saying to break up with him because of this?
No, I'm saying just leave. Don't even talk to him.
You're just being a jerk.
Oh, my God.
You could leave me a dear went to the John note.
You think he's all right, then?
All right, Sharon. Come on, what happened to you? You're 22. Why are you so naive or screwed up or obsessed or whatever it is? You love the guy?
Yes.
All right, well, then relax. He brought it up. You said no. He had enough respect not to,
What if he brought some other thing up you don't want to do? That's perfectly within your reasonable rights not to do things you don't want to do. And then not to feel guilty about it afterwards.
Here's a concept, too. Oftentimes, people do not want to do things to their partners that their partners don't want to do, but they don't know that. None of our listeners are callers. But what I'm saying is if I said to a girl, hey, I'd really like to do this to you, and she said, oh, boy, that would be really uncomfortable. I really wouldn't want to do that. Then I would stop wanting to do it to her. Because sexually, I don't want to do something to someone that's going to bring them down or make them uncomfortable.
That's right.
And the fact that they didn't like it, I wouldn't do it. I mean, just, you know, think about oral sex for a second. If I thought for a second a girl didn't like it, I wouldn't get near that thing. You kidding me?
She might bite.
Yeah, I mean, are you kidding? But if you find out they like it, you're down for the long haul. At least at the beginning of the relationship. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
Of course, it's all based on where they like it. So maybe this guy asked her and she said no, and he thought, well, she doesn't like it, so he moved on. Wow, that is weird. All right, Drew. Drew, what happened to your wondrous antenna?
It's not working in here.
What a surprise. Jamie?
Yeah, hi.
You're 16.
Yeah.
What's up?
Well, ever since the last time I've had sex, since then I can start kissing with a boy, but I can't get past that point. Like, I feel uncomfortable when it starts to go past that.
Because you don't want to have sex again?
I'm not sure if it's, like, I just feel that that's what's automatically going to happen, or...
Why did it happen in the first place if you weren't into that? Why did it happen in the first place if you weren't into that?
Well, the first time it was just, like, it was totally spontaneous. It was an Australian pro tennis player. It was kind of like, hey.
By the name of.
I lost it to an Australian pro tennis player first around, too. Wow, that sounds pretty good. Was he wearing his sweatband on his head when he did you?
No.
But he must have been an attractive guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, what happened? Then he went left town?
Yeah, it was totally just like that's all it was.
Are you guys staying in the same hotel or something?
No, my mom was doing the housing for the tournament.
Oh,
nice. You see what that life is? What a life. You tagged along with those little socks with the little puffy balls on the back of it.
How old was he?
He was 17.
Mm. Well, yeah, not bad.
Yeah.
Hey, Jamie, you been to a lot of those tennis tournaments?
Yeah, my mom's a big tennis player.
Yeah, you know what's sort of lame about those things? You notice all the guys and women sort of dressed like tennis players at the tennis match?
Yeah.
They're wearing those like Fila shorts, they had tennis balls stuffed in them, they're wearing K-Swiss shoes, they're wearing $100 tennis shirts. I mean, they act like someone's going to point at them and call them down to play. You're in. I twisted an ankle. Get in here. And it's really weird. I mean, it's sort of lame because it's not that sort of that hoodlum Oakland Raiders crowd who's up there wearing the Biletnikoff jerseys. These are like rich white guys who look really stupid in $300 sweaters, but they wear tennis outfits to the tennis game.
But it's not just that. They wear it, like, wherever they go. They wear those clothes.
Oh,
like,
I know.
To go shopping or whatever.
That whole part of life where you go, hey, I'm into this, and everybody's going to know it now because I'm going to dress like I'm on the circuit. It's a weird thing to me.
Oh, and Nick?
Yeah.
I'm going to see you at the Greek Theater May 28th.
Yeah, you wouldn't get
totally
the...
What is that, San Fran?
Yeah.
Berkeley.
Yeah.
Cool.
You wouldn't get the creeps if he kissed you, would you, Jamie?
What?
You wouldn't get the creeps if Nick kissed you, would you?
God, no.
All right. All right, well, listen, you're fine, I think.
Like, sound pretty well adjusted.
It's going to be like a stage, like a phase I'm going to get out of it, or it's something that I need to get over.
Well, look, it was not a great experience you had with this guy, and it's something that you're trying to avoid now and do more thoughtfully, and it's appropriate.
All right.
You'll find a guy that gets you all hot and bothered and you want to do it with eventually.
Yeah, maybe a pro golfer. Rachel?
Yes.
You're 20.
Yes.
What's up?
I went to the gynecologist recently.
and he told me that my uterus tips to the back. And Dr. Drew, I just wanted to know, is there going to be any health risks for me during pregnancy?
No. It's a very common thing.
Oh, really?
Nothing. It's no big deal.
Is it possible she gives birth to an Asian child?
No.
No.
Not even that.
And did the gynecologist refer you to Dr. Drew, not answer this question for you? Like, you've got this condition, but I'm not telling you what it's going to do.
I may be a certified gynecologist who's currently looking up your vagina, but I suggest you call a nameless, faceless radio show late night and see if you can get some answers over someone who's eating popcorn and has his head buried in his mini computer and is not really listening to your question. Okay, that'll be $182.
Thanks.
All right, Rachel.
All right, thanks.
You talk to your gyno.
Yeah, I will.
All right. Is it a man or a woman?
It's a man. You know, I really wasn't comfortable with him. It was like the first time I had a visit with him. He was really awkward and sharp and quick with me. I just...
All right, you may need somebody else.
Well, that's just breeding, if you really think about it. Yeah. I mean, a short gynecologist, you know what I mean?
Oh, okay.
You wouldn't want some guy who's 6'8". He'd throw his back out trying to get down to the vagina.
Yeah, like I would think so.
Yeah. Short, I mean, think about that.
They eat grapefruits all the time.
Yeah, they have certain dogs are bred for certain things, you know? Drew?
Whatever you say, I'm working hard on your thing here. It's not working.
No kidding.
All kinds of things about 98 and 99.
Let me say something about this crappy computer world we're living in. I don't know how to use one. I never use one. I can't stand these things. I complain about them constantly. Everyone tells me this is the greatest invention ever. It's going to change your life. Once a year, I ask somebody to open a computer and find something, and then there's trouble. It blows up. They can't find what they're looking for. It seemed like the world's easiest task. Just find the lineup for the 2000 Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach celebrity race. But that's too tall an order for
Drew. That's what I'm using.
What are you using?
Ask Jeeve.
Candace?
Yep.
You're 21. What's up?
Hey, well, whenever I'm having sex and I'm on the verge of the big O.
Yeah.
I start to throw up.
Wow. Every time?
Yeah.
Whether you're with somebody or by yourself?
Mm-hmm.
With someone or by yourself?
Well, with someone.
How about by yourself?
No.
Okay. Okay, hold on a second. I'm putting you on hold because of your inability to answer a very straight question. With yourself? With someone or by yourself? Uh-huh. Yeah. With someone or by yourself? Uh-huh. Well, not when I'm by myself. God, I know I say it every week. I challenge any radio show, local or national. I'll put the stupidity of my callers up against yours any day, and I'll win hands down. Hands down. That's one thing I'm confident in them about. We'll crush any competitor when it comes to stupidity. We should have the stupidity challenge. Alan?
Yeah.
He loves his fans.
You're
you can
15.
Tell. He loves his fans.
No, I'm tired of all of you. Stop calling the show.
15.
What's up there, Alan?
Yeah, I'm 15. I just wanted to say hi to Nick. You're my idol. I have all your music. Listen to your music every day.
Right on, man. Thanks.
All right. Adam, I just wanted to say, the Man Show, we started up our own club at school, and they shut us down after about 3 meetings.
Hallelujah.
You have a Man Show club?
Yeah. We couldn't call it the Man Club, so we called it the Gentleman's Club.
That is excellent.
All right.
Oh, do we got good stuff planned for you in this new season, Alan.
All right.
You are going to be proud.
All right.
Proud to wear your testicles.
Yeah.
What's up?
My question, Dr. Drew, is my sister is right across, is right next, her room is right next to mine.
Mm-hmm.
And she makes, like, moans during the night. And, I mean, I'm not sure what it is. My parents' room is downstairs, so they never hear it. But I'm not sure what to do about it because it wakes me up during the night.
How old's your sister?
She's 19.
No. Is she alone?
I'm not sure. I don't think she has a boyfriend.
Well, what I mean is there somebody on her, or is she just sleeping and groaning?
She's alone during the night, I'm pretty sure.
Well, why do you have to do anything about it?
Because it's waking me up during the night. Like,
just bang on the door, bang on the wall when she, you know.
Yeah.
Put her on notice that you hear it, that's all.
You got to train people. I just flick a cigarette butt at her.
Okay, they mean go during the night and knock on her door?
No, just bang on the wall. Wherever you hear it, just bang.
Well, is it across the hall or is it on the next room next to yours?
Oh, it's right next to mine.
Right next to yours. All right, bang on the wall.
Bang on the wall.
Yeah.
Just let her know that you hear it and that's that. She'll stop if she's aware of it or awake or can stop it.
Okay.
Yeah, it'll train her. People can be trained. They hate it. Like when they snore and you wake them up every time they start snoring,
mm-hmm.
they'll stop eventually. Or they'll stop like immediately, like when you push them. It's good to throw stuff at people. You know what I miss most about being a kid or a teenager? It's like really torturing people that are asleep. You know, like where you go, take a magic marker, draw a mustache and a penis on their forehead. Or you take
I know.
Some
Once
duct
you hit
tape.
30, that doesn't happen no more.
Yeah, I know. What's up? I'm hoping it's something I get back into in a few years. I miss it.
I've heard it. There's a resurgence at 40. That's what.
Oh, really? Start,
yeah.
You like catch your second wind? I miss effing around with my friends. Well, see, here's what it was. First, it was them asleep. You know, this is like 9, 10, 11, you know, teenage years. And then later on, it became them passed out, which is a little bit different. It was like they drank too much and hit their head on something. And that's when the duct taping and the real serious abuse came in. That was great fun. Mm-hmm. And now there's nothing to do. If someone falls asleep, you just leave them there. I don't like that. I'm going to have to work and use it, like dump water on their crotch and torture them. It was great.
There's an Adam, here's a Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach facts and trivia page.
No. See if you can give me the 99 lineup. Maybe that'll work.
Well, that'd be the facts and trivia page.
All right. Well, look that up. Well, let's hear something from 311. This is, you queued up there, Anderson? Yep. This one's called Large in the Margin.
Keep coming back to remind.
Yep.
Crowd goes nuts.
Never heard a bad 311 song.
Thank you.
Yeah. Not had a good one either, but no, I'm just kidding. No, I really haven't. I don't know. I haven't heard every 311 song. There may be a stinker out there, but they all sound good to me. They have, there's a certain sort of general component that they all have that makes them all good. Yeah, well, and you don't have to hear them over and over again to like them either. Some bands and some artists, it's the 150th time I hear the song that I realize I liked it. It's usually, if I hear it the first five times, I don't hate it, then it means I'm going to love it at some point. I don't know if that's the same for everybody or if that's different. Or does everyone have that? Like, you hear a song and you just don't like it as much as the 10th time you've heard it. I don't mean sitting down and hearing it 10 times in a row, but if it's on the radio and you hear it over the course of a couple of months or something like that. Ooh.
Oh, boy.
Taboo 2 theme song. This one I knew I was in love with the first time I heard it, except for my Johnson was out, and I was having at myself, so it wasn't quite fair.
Having at.
Yeah, that's a hot song. You guys think you might want to cover the Taboo 2 theme song?
It's the first I'd heard of it, but I'm a fan now, too, so yeah.
Okay, good. As long as you'll commit to it, that'd be great. Kristen?
Yeah?
You're 26.
Hey, Adam.
Hey.
You're wonderful.
Wow, well, thanks.
You're my current obsession right now.
Wow.
I think you're great.
How long has this obsession lasted for?
It's been going on for a few months now. A
few months?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a few years ago, and then I lost track of your show for a while, but now I'm back.
Oh, great. And when you say obsession, what does that mean exactly?
I just have to, listen every night. I have to watch The Man Show.
Ooh.
I watch it twice a week.
Yeah.
And I get all my, like, hippie, moon-loving, pagan witch friends to watch it.
Oh,
totally repulsed by it.
Now, listen, I say horrible things about those Wiccan chicks all the time.
They're ridiculous.
But you have a lot of them are friends of yours, right?
Yeah, just at this point, they're just... I've come to know a bunch of them.
I see.
From working and stuff.
They're all fat, aren't they?
Mostly.
Yeah. Chicks don't find the Wicca religion unless they're husky.
Right.
I don't know what that is. Good-looking chicks don't get bothered with that nonsense. Yeah, maybe it's the long flowing stuff. Yeah, it's more flattering. Yeah, if the religion relied more on cycling shorts and spandex, I don't think there'd be as many husky chicks attracted to it.
Right.
Very good point. Anyway, Kristen, what's your question?
I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Uh-huh.
I was on Klonopin, and they took me off of it because of its addictive properties.
Right.
And put me on Ambien.
Are you an addict?
Yeah.
Well, that explains the obsession or attraction.
No,
meaning what, a former addict of something else?
I'm 2 years clean.
You either have that biology or you don't. If you're not, if you don't have the biology, you're
That's
not
That's why addict. I said yes, but I'm 2 years clean at this point.
Okay,
so.
Ambien is, you can't, I've yet to see somebody maintain sobriety on Ambien or Klonopin. Eventually.
Okay, well they took me off the Ambien and put me on Valium, which is.
All addictive.
Hey,
all addictive.
Hey though, Kristen, I've taken that Ambien, right, Drew?
Yeah,
I need more of that.
You just took some. Just now.
Yeah, I mean, I'm out. I just finished my last 5. What about the Valium?
What about it?
Is that good?
It's addictive.
Well, how's it compared to the Ambien, Kristen?
The Ambien's the only thing that's worked.
Oh, really? But what gets
worked
you
a for what?
What gets
what's
you a better buzz?
Here?
It's for the Ambien does.
Oh, it does?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll stick with that. Go ahead,
no,
Kristen.
No, well, never mind.
You need help sleeping?
Yeah. Because I'm bipolar, and when I have my manic episodes, sometimes I need help sleeping.
Well, if it's again, sometimes it's worth taking risk with these medications if it's important that another illness be treated. And indeed, if your mania is out of control, that has to be treated, and there may need for a short period of time to use some benzodiazepine. But it's treacherous. It's treacherous.
Look at this for a second. Hold on, Daniel.
Yeah.
Who's this?
Daniel.
You're Daniel.
Daniel Kellison.
Yeah.
Hey, Daniel.
Buddy.
Hey,
what do you
buddy.
Got? What do you got?
This is the executive producer for The Man Show, by the way. Hey, you in the office?
Yeah.
Oh, you never stop working.
How about that?
It's that alcoholic gene.
That's right.
Hey, have you seen Daniel's package lately, Drew?
His package?
Oh, he is huge.
So humiliating.
He got bigger from doing crank.
He wears these really tight jeans every day to work, and yeah, the chicks go nuts.
Oh, please.
Daniel,
I'm married.
Big penis. Are you? That's why she married you.
Are you Daniel, help. I'm looking for this page for Adam, so quit bugging me.
I got it. You want to know who's racing?
Are you off the speakerphone, Daniel?
Yeah.
Thank you.
How the hell did you find this thing?
Oh, he's a genius. He's not like you.
How did you find it?
No, it was in, it was, he actually had to search a little bit, but it was under the pro celebrity section of this Long Beach website.
Yeah.
Of Long Beach, the city of Long Beach.
The news release page, and then the news release, they had the list of the celebrities who were competing.
Genius, that Daniel.
All right.
So you want me to start with the lower rung or the higher rung?
Start high and let's work our way down.
All right. Well, George Lucas.
All right, I've heard of him.
Ashley Judd.
All right, celebrity.
Christian Slater.
All right, he's out. Would they like parole him to do the race?
Apparently.
He's got the gene.
He's gonna have his car being followed like by a patrolman. All right, these are all big stars.
John Elway.
All right, another big star.
Here's where we start getting a little. Sketchy. Allison Hannigan.
No, she's from
well, Buffy the Vampire.
First off, yeah, it's true.
She was in American Pie.
She's not
right?
that big a star because she did this show.
Yeah.
Okay, I didn't know who she was.
No offense, Nick. not you, Nick. Not you, buddy. You're golden. You shouldn't be here. Leave now.
Run my side.
I'm slumming.
No. We get a lot of big bands. It's the actors and actresses where we go bottom shelf with.
Antonio Sabato Jr.
All right.
He's listed as Calvin Klein model and author of No Excuses.
Oh, yeah.
He's a writer.
Yeah, he's a well-known writer. I think they're going to make that book into a movie.
Rachel Hunter and Josh Brolin.
Josh Brolin would be James Brolin's son.
I think that's right.
And he, of course, we know from Sandy Beach and Aaron Spelling production that was canceled 10 years ago or something like that.
Yeah.
All right, Josh Brolin.
But I seem to think that his dad also raced, maybe,
And my dad wasn't in the race?
Maybe not. Yeah. Maybe it's that you have to be a legacy.
Hold on. Yeah, one more reason to hate my dad. Let me write that down. Reason 2,522 did not get me into the time show to Grand Prix of Long Beach.
Yeah.
All right.
And Sean Palmer.
The snowboard. Yeah, right. He's been on this show, too. He's not a big celebrity. Right. Well, hold on, Daniel. Do you have any more?
That's it, buddy.
We got to take a break. Hold on a second. Hey, I'll see you tomorrow morning.
All right. Bye-bye.
Thanks for calling in, Jim. All right. We'll take ourselves a little break.
I'm going to go to the chat rooms at drdrew.com instead, since I'm on the web here.
All right, wise ass. We'll be back after this.
LoveLine, 1-800-LOVE-191. Back in a minute.
Well, it's worth hearing.
Saturday, 1400 hours, Army Reserve exercise. Your unit must locate a new water supply for a small town. In under 2 hours, water from a lake is treated and made safe to drink. On Saturday, you learn to handle pressure in the Army Reserve. So on Monday, it's easy back at college to handle a certain biology professor.
Your answer, please, Miss Perez. The class is waiting.
Plasma, sir.
Excellent.
Serve as little as 1 weekend a month, 2 weeks a year. Earn money for college. Visit the Army Reserve at GoArmyReserve.com. Paid for by the U.S. Army Reserve.
I'm talking to a real live Geico auto insurance customer, Jackie Gelman. Jackie, you filed a claim with Geico. How fast was it handled?
It was fast.
As fast as a cheetah chasing a frightened antelope on the African plains, Jackie?
Well, it was fast.
Voila! Claims handled as fast as a cheetah at dinner time, give or take a few antelope. One 15-minute call could save you 15% or more. Call 1-800-947-AUTO. 1-800-947-AUTO. Geico Direct, the sensible alternative.
Hi, I'm Serenity, and these are my friends, Missy and Stephanie.
You know, a lot of things happen to us every day that we have no control over.
But HIV and other sexually transmitted diseases aren't things that just happen to you. You do have a choice.
You can choose to use a condom, have safe sex, and take control of your life.
Asking for a condom isn't stupid. It's smart. It shows that you care about yourself and your partner. You can do something about sexually transmitted diseases.
Use a condom.
Every partner. Every time.
We do.
A message brought to you by Wicked Pictures and AIDS Project Los Angeles.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken? Everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool. Join the crowd. Have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go. She's no fun.
Make the right choice. Don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Somewhere in our community is a mother whose drug abuse once left her unable to care for her kids. There's a father, too, whose alcohol use drove his wife and children away. There's a boyfriend whose drug use frightened his girlfriend into giving him an ultimatum. Get help. Help is available. It's in the form of treatment programs for drug abuse and alcohol problems. And the good news is that these programs are making a big difference in people's lives. With proper treatment, mothers and fathers, sweethearts and coworkers, friends and neighbors are overcoming drug and alcohol problems and reclaiming their lives. Isn't it great that treatment works? To find out about drug and alcohol treatment programs that can help, call 1-800-662-HELP. That's 1-800-662-HELP. There is help, and it works. A public service of this station and the Center for Substance Abuse Treatment.
Dad, I don't think our campfire's totally out.
Are you kidding me? I know when a campfire's out.
Did you drown the fire with water and stir it with a stick?
No, it's out. We don't have to... Who said that?
Frank, it's a talking moose with sunglasses.
And a bunch of singing and dancing forest animals.
We know we can count on you to do what Smokey says.
And when your folks desire to build a fire.
Hot, hot.
Clear brush and branches away.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And keep water nearby like you oughta.
We're all counting on you.
Okay, I poured water on the fire. I stirred it with a stick. Everybody walked slowly toward the RV.
Dad, these are just Smokey's friends.
Only you can prevent forest fires.
Frank, it's Smokey.
Nice hat, Smokey. Want the rest of my peanut butter sandwich?
Dad!
Visit Smokey at www.smokeybear.com. Brought to you by the USDA Forest Service, the National Association of State Foresters, and the Ad Council.
That is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191.
I'm not getting on anywhere.
Good. Shut that computer. That confounded.
Now device. That I'm not interested in not searching for you.
You did nothing for me. I had to have my second backup male lover, Daniel Kellison from The Man Show, call in and bail us out of that one. Nick Hexum is here from 311. Sound System's the name of the CD. And we'll hop back on the phones and speak to Valerie. Valerie?
Yes?
You're 15. What's up?
Yes. Well, my boyfriend, he does weights, and I want to know if, like, it would affect him any way in his penis.
If he drops one on it, yeah. Is that what you're talking about?
Is he taking steroids?
No.
No. You sure?
Yeah, I'm sure.
A lot of these guys do it without telling anybody.
Huh?
A lot of people who lift weights, Drew
Excuse
says,
will do that stuff without telling anybody. They keep it very quiet.
Is he getting really big really fast?
No.
No. Okay. I'm sure he'd be glad to hear that.
So.
No. All right, Valerie. Don't worry. His penis is not going to shrink because he's exercising. Goofball.
Hey, Adam, I love you, 311. I love you guys, too. You guys are the bomb.
Thanks.
Thanks. All right.
Adam, you're like my God, I swear. I listen to you this show every day.
Oh, really?
Except Fridays and Sundays.
Well, listen. Jeez, that's almost half the show. Although we're not on Fridays, are we,
Drew? No.
Thank God. All right, hey, Valerie.
Uh-huh?
As your God, I command you not to get pregnant.
Oh, yeah. And when you take the shot, what is that thing called?
Depo-Provera?
Yeah, something like that. Do you get weight with that?
Do you gain weight? Not typically.
No.
But some people, you could, but not typically.
You won't. Not you won't. You're going to gain the ounce of liquid that is shot into you, and that's it.
You will gain weight with pregnancy, though.
Yes. You'll gain a ton of weight. You understand?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. That depo will make your penis shrink, though. I do want to warn you about that. All right, there. She's an easy audience, that. Josh.
Yeah.
You're 18. What's going on?
All right. Me and my girlfriend have had sex numerous amount of times.
All right.
And everything seems to be fine for me. Like, we were each other's first, but it seems to be fine with me.
How old is she?
She's 18 also.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And she...
Let me guess. She doesn't have orgasms.
She, yes.
Oh, but, shocking.
Yeah.
All right.
And that's never happened before to an 18-year-old woman.
She is really, really nervous. I just told her that it's got to be technique or something.
No.
Because I don't know, but she's really, really nervous about it.
About what?
About not being an orgasm. She thinks that something's wrong with her. I mean, I don't know what to do or tell her about that.
Well,
keep trying.
Has she ever had an orgasm on her own?
No, I don't think she has.
Have you ever asked her that?
I've asked her, but she tells me no.
Okay.
I mean, we've done, like, she says she starts to feel, like, pleasure.
Yeah.
Then, like, just, like, little hits of it here and there.
Sure.
But never, like, enough to orgasm.
No. Hey, Josh?
Yeah.
I've been doing some serious thinking about this topic, this orgasm woman topic.
Yeah.
It seems easy. You know what it seems like? It only through oral sex can these women have orgasms.
Most of them, yeah.
I swear to Christ, I don't think I've ever given a woman an orgasm through intercourse. But, and I've nailed at
nice
least four
does,
women
though,
in my 35
no
years.
But
what's
you know,
that,
it's nice when you find one that does. Well, that's what's interesting. The ones that do have orgasm during sex don't really like oral sex so much and are bewildered by women that need oral sex.
I got to get one of them. Boy, do I got to get that one. I've only met women who have them via oral sex. Now, they enjoy the intercourse, and they get kind of close, and you can tell they kind of like it, but you to finish them off, it's you gotta go down the basement and stoke the furnace.
Stoke the furnace.
Start loading coal, brother. And it's a bitch for me because of my deviated septum. I can't breathe down there. Getting all that cotton mouth and whatnot. But I just get down there and start licking away. I wouldn't assume they can have it. It seems like they can. I wish someone would have told me this when I was younger, but they can't. Look, when you're a kid and you go to a vending machine, you see the Snickers bars and all the potato chips and everything, and they're just out of your reach, and you think, I'll just slide my arm up this big slot in the bottom, I'll reach up, and I'll grab one of these things. And it seems so easy, and there it is, and you see your hand going up, and you can see your hand, you can wave at yourself through the glass, but you just can't quite get to that Snickers bar. That's what it is. I'm saying forget about trying to get it. Just go get some change from the Oriental guy who's got the liquor store across the
Oriental
street.
Oriental guy.
Well, yeah, they have
they like
all
to be called that. Don't they
have all the liquor stores. Well, you
need
say,
to go through the Museum of Tolerance.
You want to call them gook? Are you kidding me? Please, how dare you two?
It's right down the street.
Teresa.
Oh, hi, Nick.
Hi.
You're 18.
I just wanted to wish you a happy early birthday.
Thanks.
Today's my 18th birthday.
Happy birthday to you,
Nick. When is your birthday?
The 12th.
How old are you going to be?
30.
That's the perfect age to rock.
30.
What is that? That's a good answer, huh? I didn't know what rock was until I was 30. Drew, how about you?
I still don't know.
There you go. What's up there, Teresa?
I've known this guy for 3 years now, and we've been really good friends. We've gotten, like, really close and stuff. And I've been going out with him for almost 3 weeks now.
Mm-hmm.
And I was talking to his mom earlier today, and I found out he has a kid in Florida that he never told me about.
Oh, boy. How old is he?
He's 22. I haven't approached him yet. I haven't talked to him since, and I don't know if I should confront him or.
You said he's 32?
He's 22.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, and are you getting serious about this?
Well, we have been. I thought we have been really good friends, and I've told him like everything, and we just talk a lot. And
what city are you calling from?
Colorado.
How long have you been with him? Are you seeing him kind of?
What the hell is that?
I'm
a question?
Choking on something. How long have you been talking to him?
We've known each other for 3 years.
But how long have you been becoming sort of serious?
Not, people give answers like it's like they have Oliver North's goddamn attorney next to them. Who molested you? A family member. Which family member?
Not answer on the ground.
Was not my father or my mother. Yeah. It's like just. We've been talking for three. Have you ever given that answer? I mean, if someone said to you, like, how long have you been with your girlfriend?
I've known her for 12 years.
We established a dialogue in 1994.
Our acquaintance has
grown. It's like, no, it's like
we met in kindergarten.
It serves to confuse people. Yeah. It's like, did you guys work together for 5 years before you got it on, or what's going on here? When did you give an answer? Oh, I hate everyone except for you guys. Teresa?
Yeah.
You guys have been talking for 3 years.
Well, it was 3 years ago that I met him, and we worked together, and then, like, probably 6 months after that, we started, like, hanging out.
Okay, so hold on. Let me write this down.
Get the whole chronology down.
3 years ago is when you met. Uh-huh. And 6 months after that, started hanging out. So now we're back. We're down to about 2.5 years. You want to keep going? Keep going, goofball.
Take your time.
Yeah, how long have you been dating?
It'll be 3 weeks tomorrow.
Oh,
Jesus Christ.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, but, yeah, I would get that. I don't know why, and I want to apologize. I really do, Teresa, because when someone says, we've been talking for 3 years, I should know that translates into we've been dating for three weeks. Jesus Christ. I swear to Christ, if anyone wants to challenge my listeners, I'll bring them on. Bring on your stupidest. Teresa, I'll put you clean up. And you'll be batting number 4 in the retard lineup.
We have to establish whether or not Teresa has a trustworthy sort of antenna.
Oh, I don't care.
No, come
on,
Teresa. Is your dad around?
Yeah.
And you have...
Hold on. Yeah. That could mean a lot of
things.
Yeah,
of course.
Yeah.
He's around. He lives with your mother?
Yeah.
And you live with them?
Yeah.
Okay. And he's a good guy?
Yeah.
Okay. And this guy you chose, well, it's only been 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I wouldn't worry about it.
Should I confront him about it? Should I ask
him? Why don't you give him a little more time?
Why don't you ask him about it? Have I ever used the word confront? I mean, our listeners also want to confront everybody about everything.
You could just kind of, you know, hedge the topic by saying, how do you feel about kids, you know, and then if he doesn't mention that he's already got one, then it's going to be pretty obvious. He's a... bad character.
Well, I think we're living in a day and age of like Jerry Springer and Jenny Jones, mm-hmm. where everything has to be a goddamn bum rush. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like you have to confront everyone head on about everything. Yeah, just go ahead and start weave something into a conversation.
Yeah, you ever
use some tact. Be subtle. See what he says. But
exactly.
I don't know. If I started dating a girl and I liked her and we were only 3 weeks into it, I'm not sure I would say anything just yet. And especially if I liked her, I'd be worried I might scare her off. On the other hand, they've been talking for 3 years.
Ooh.
I wonder why he's never brought up the fact that he has a child if they've been friends.
She's been into him from the beginning. He probably knew it.
Okay. All right. We're going to take ourselves a little break. Nick Hexum's here from 311. And when we come back, we'll speak to Melissa, who gets extremely wet during sex, which is just like my partner Drew. After this.
LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
1-800-LOVE-191. Ow, 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 you kill me, say
bow, ow, you kill me. We'll be right back.
This is a story about American heroes. They changed quite a few lives last year. Jorge Vasquez put out fires. But no, he's not a firefighter. Philip Dale discovered several new stars. Oh, he's not an astronomer. And Elaine Capobianco. She saved a child from drowning, but she's not a lifeguard. They're teachers. But to the kids they've reached, they're heroes.
I'm a teacher. The children are the heroes.
We're not just teaching subject matter, we're teaching human beings.
I am tough as nails, but they know that I love them.
I mean, we've got a legacy that follows behind us forever.
Teachers have the power to make an impact on our future. California will need about 250,000 more of them in the next 10 years. Reach for that power. Teach. Call 1-888-CAL-TEACH now. A public service message brought to you by CalTeach, the Ad Council, and this station.
Okay, so I'm a teenager, right? And everyone's so quick to judge me. On the outside, I may look like... but on the inside, I'm all...
feeling. Whoa, 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 feeling.
Just because I look like... doesn't mean I act that way. In fact, I'm actually involved in crime prevention. That sounds more like this. It's really a great way to convince adults that while you may be looking, you're really thinking.
Call 1-800-722-TEENS to find out how to make your community a safer place for everyone. Get involved. Get the number and call. 1-800-722-TEENS. A public service message from the Crime Prevention Coalition of America, the U.S. Department of Justice, and the Ad Council.
Evening, folks. I'm Vince.
And I'm Larry. We're the Crash Test Dummies.
We'd like to entertain you with a little song. Only one thing.
We can't sing. But we're here with someone who can, with a song for the little ones. Ray?
Mr. Charles?
On the big highway of life, there's only one safe place for kids.
Backseat, baby.
The front seat's not the place to drop out.
Backseat, baby.
Put that booties in the backseat.
Backseat, baby.
I back some kids you never meet. To put them behind you.
Raimondo, do you mind if we try?
Oh,
backseat, baby, better buckled in the back.
Backseat, baby.
Baby faces stay intact.
Larry, wow. Yo, Larry, maybe you should keep your day job.
Ow, that hurts.
Not as much as our day job.
Woo! Backseat, baby.
You stay alive even when I drive.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids in the backseat. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
Dear Jim, I just wanted to tell you the things I love so much about you. Like your pasty white belly and how it fits in those tight shirts that my friends think you shouldn't be wearing. I love how you do that thing where you mash four slices of bread into a massive ball of dough and stuff it in your mouth. That's so adorable. And what about when you tell those same jokes from reruns that you've seen over and over again? They make me laugh every single time. Other guys play sports or go running or do something outside, but not you. You're different.
Guys, rest assured you will never in your life meet a girl like this.
P.S. I can't wait until we cuddle in front of pro wrestling all day this Saturday. I hear it's a steel cage Texas death match.
Get some exercise. Get up. Get out. A public service message brought to you by the Ad Council and the President's Council on Physical Fitness and Sports.
LoveLine. I'm Adam Kroll. That is Dr. Drew. Nick Hexum's our guest tonight from 311. Sound System is the name of the CD. It's out. You should go get it if you haven't already, but I'll assume by the callers that most of our listeners have it. And I got to tell you, I know it sounds like I'm just kissing more band ass here, but we have a lot of bands on the show, and we don't usually get too many calls for them.
That's right.
I usually feel bad for them. I said, we'll have bands on the show that are decent-sized bands, sold a few records, and we'll sit here for 2 hours and get one call. Now, part of it is I'm sure the screener tells them to get lost because it's mostly about relationships and venereal disease and whatnot, but been quite a few quite
it's really
calls.
Cool. A lot of fans called up, and a lot of fans have called for you, and so far tonight, no one has called for Dr. Drew, so I have to tell this story. I was having dinner with a friend tonight, and she was like, I love Dr. Drew. I have some questions I'd like to ask him. And I was like, what? Like, will you marry me? She was like, exactly.
Oh, yeah.
So you got a fan.
Oh, that's nice.
The ladies,
I got one.
They love Dr. Drew, the ladies do. Not his wife, but the ladies. They love him. I mean, I think your wife did love you at some point.
Yeah, I think at some point.
Melissa?
Yes?
You're 25, and you get extremely wet during sex.
And your phone number is.
And you want to know if that's a bad thing.
Well, not necessarily. I mean, I've never had any complaints, but sometimes I get too wet where I really can't feel anything.
Yeah.
Wow.
I'm just curious if there's anything that can be done. I mean, yeah, if I can do anything about it.
Well, it's a little rough on the guy, too, because you do need a certain degree of friction.
Right.
I mean, if it's like screwing a mayonnaise jar.
Well, I mean, it's not I mean, like glass that of water. Bad, but I mean, it's
yeah.
Like, you touch me and I'm wet.
Nice.
And it's not from like if I come, I mean I get wet as well.
But I could dry you up.
Just like, oh.
All right. Now what do you say, Drew? What if the guy put a condom on? Do you think that would add a little more friction?
No, she's producing like that.
What if she got on some of that, acne medication or
something? Oh, yeah, that would do it. Yeah. That's true. That would probably do
it. See, I could be a doctor.
Yeah, interesting. But I don't think anybody would do that, but interesting
idea.
Squeeze
a tube of that Oxy-10 up you, and it'll dry you right up.
No, I think it's just something you need to work with. It's you.
Right.
That's all.
Just get used to it and work with it.
Yep.
Well, it's
there's a lot of worse problems than that.
Yes.
It's been working okay for
you. I was like, and most guys are like, oh no, I love it, it's great. But me, I'm like,
Melissa,
I don't really like it. Yeah.
I'm gonna give you a tip because I did have this problem once with a girlfriend about 7 or 8 years ago. I used to spread kitty litter on her vagina. It really worked. It works. Like, you know, when a transmission leaks and a big puddle in the driveway, throw some kitty litter on there. Sweep it up. It really absorbs the whole thing. I'm not talking about a whole sack of kitty litter, but just take a funnel and work a little in there.
There's a product idea in there somewhere. Vaginal dry up kitty litter.
Yeah. Now, be careful if you fall asleep because cats are a condition of that smell. And,
they'll
it's
come around, huh?
Very embarrassing.
Start digging?
Very embarrassing, yes. Maria?
Yes?
You're 20.
Right.
What's up? Jesus, you've been on hold for 95 minutes?
Yeah.
Oh. You're a trooper.
Thank you. First of all, I wanted to say happy early birthday to Nick.
Thank you.
And I love you guys.
Thank you.
And you're welcome. And what's been going on is I was on Depo for about a year, and then I went off, and about 6 months later or something, I finally started getting my period back. And after that, I started getting really red and dry and itchy on my lips, you know, the labia. And I went to the gynecologist, and she said that everything was fine. She checked me out. Told me to use vinegar for a while and then come back again if it was bothering me. Mm-hmm. And I did, and she said it still looked okay, that there was no problem, just when I came back in for a pap smear to, you know, tell them about it. And I'm going in a month, but it's still coming, and I'm wondering if there's something more that I need to tell them about to have them look into.
Are you on any medication?
I'm on Ritalin, and...
It's your medication.
Alexa.
It's your medication.
So what should she do with that?
Wait, for what? She just told me to take vinegar.
It's your medication that's doing this to you.
It is?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Okay? Just talk to her about the medication, the other medications.
Ritalin and Celexa.
Didn't we talk to her?
Candace throws up right before orgasm. Yeah, we did talk to her. Oh, but I think I yelled at her.
Oh, you put on hold for, oh boy.
And now she's been on hold for 70 minutes. You see, you screwballs, you F around with me, and this is what you get. Don't make me be evil again, Candace.
I'm glad you value my stupidity.
I really do. And let me explain something else to you, screwballs. You think I feel bad about this? I go home and sleep like a baby. I laugh all the way home. I light a cigar with a $20 bill, have a shot of cognac, and then laugh like a madman before I get into bed. I never think about any of you.
He's just a dick. Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
All right, Candace.
The girl's calling. I love you, Adam.
That's right.
Oh,
the
my
ones
God.
That are the ones that are ex junkies.
They're
usually.
Worshiping guys in the prison.
All right, Candace, what's up?
Well, when I'm on the verge of an orgasm during sex with a partner.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's right.
I start to throw up.
All right. That's his right. Same partner?
Yeah. Well, like different people.
And any partner.
How many times has this happened?
Like 10.
10 times, 10 different people.
Yeah, about.
Have you ever had a relationship with someone that worked?
Well, yeah, but, like, it was, like, my first couple times.
And you're sober when, you know, you're doing this. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm hearing it in your voice, Candace. Somebody did something to you.
No, not really.
Well, a little bit. Come on.
Well, I'm just a little tired. I've been on hold for so long, you know, because you yelled at me.
Yeah. And I'm really
you're the one that messed her up.
I'm really getting I'm getting a vibe off of Candace.
Yeah.
Candace?
Uh-huh.
Now listen, I don't want to get in a big argument with you, but just be truthful with me.
Uh-huh.
Or be truthful with yourself. Do you not like guys that much? I mean, you like them, but you know what I mean? There's a part of you that feels a little hostile toward them?
No, not at all.
Not at all?
Not at all.
And you like your dad?
Love him.
You love your dad?
Yeah.
And nobody's ever, do you talk to him?
Uh-huh.
Okay, what's he do for a living?
He's a firefighter.
Uh-oh. And you've never been mistreated by a man?
No.
Never been molested or raped or anything like that?
Nope.
Trying to figure out why you throw up when you have sex. You're allergic to penis. I think it's a reaction that you're having, an emotional reaction.
Yeah.
You have any explanation for that?
Well, the first couple times I tried it, I was, like, really young.
How old?
Like, my first time I was 15.
Mm. Yeah.
And then since I was, like 18 or 19.
Have you had a relationship with any of these guys?
A few of them.
Mm. How old was the guy when you were 15?
16.
Huh.
All right. And nothing, where's your mom? You get along with her?
Yeah, she's great.
Nothing weird happened?
No, nothing at all.
What's the weirdest, scariest thing that ever happened to you?
I masturbate with toothpaste.
With the purpose of what?
With the container?
No.
With the actual toothpaste?
Yeah. As like a lubricant.
Mm. As a lubricant?
Yeah.
All right. Your vagina will never get gingivitis. Hold on a second.
I don't know.
I don't know what's up with her either. But man, it feels like something. Mystery. Feels like something.
Yeah.
All right, we'll take a little break. We'll be back.
Yo, Loveline will be right back, homie.
Remember what college costs in the early 80s?
Tuition?
Yeah, books, typewriter, room and board.
Well, yeah, a bundle.
Was it worth it?
Well, of course. Every penny.
And get this. Now it's over twice what you paid.
Well, yeah, but I don't have to worry about my kids' college bills for another 15 years.
Well, if costs keep hiking up and up, you'll be shelling out more in just 1 year for each of your children than you spent on yourself for all 4 years of college.
Ouch! So what do I do?
You better start saving today with U.S. Savings Bonds. They're easy to buy and afford and are guaranteed safe.
Yeah?
And savings bonds earn a treasury-based rate of interest right from the start.
Wow. Where do I find them?
At most banks. Or ask your employer about the payroll savings plan. But whatever you do, start saving now or you'll be...
rooting for a scholarship?
Exactly.
Mommy, can I have a drink of water?
Remember the last time you changed your motor oil? You let it flow down a storm drain. It found its way into our waters. So did that paint you tossed in the garbage, as well as those fertilizers you might have used a few too many of. If you think your actions have no effect on our waters, think again.
Thank you, Mommy.
You can help preserve our waters, not only for your sake, but for hers. Recycle used motor oil. Dispose of paint and household toxins properly. Practice composting and use lawn and garden products sensibly. It's a small price to pay to preserve our greatest natural resource, and the reasons for doing so can be just as small.
Good night, Mommy.
Clean water. If we all do a little, we can do a lot. To find out how to help reclaim our waters, call 1-800-504-8484. That's 1-800-504-8484. Brought to you by the Natural Resources Defense Council, the Ad Council, and the EPA.
Oh, come on, have a drink.
No, thanks.
Just one little drink.
I don't want to.
Chicken, everyone else is.
I said no.
What a nerd. One little drink won't kill you.
You've heard it all before. Be cool, join the crowd, have a drink, even though you're not 21.
Let's go, she's no fun.
Make the right choice, don't give in. Underage drinking is dumb and dangerous.
Look out!
A public service message from the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
And now, Vince and Larry, the crash test dummies with a lullaby.
Crumple, crumple, little car, when you crash, it's au revoir.
If on dumb luck you rely, through the windshield they will fly.
Keep your children off the streets, put your kids in safety seats.
Crumple, crumple, little car, don't be dummies like we are.
Gee, Vince, I'm kind of sleepy now.
Okay, Larry, just crash anywhere.
You could learn a lot from a dummy. Buckle your kids' safety belts. A message from the Department of Transportation and the Ad Council.
McGruff here at the airport with some tips that can help make your traveling safer. Pardon me, sir.
Hmm? Hey, aren't you,
McGruff, the crime dog.
Yeah, I thought I recognized the paws.
Where do you keep your wallet?
My hip pocket.
Well, look over there at that man at the ticket counter.
So?
The guy behind him in line just bumped him.
Yeah?
And he could have picked his pocket while the man was talking to the ticket agent, just like someone could have picked yours while you were looking over there.
Oh, gosh.
Put your wallet in your front pants pocket or your briefcase.
Oh, yeah, really, sure.
Another thing, hold on to that laptop computer all the time. Don't put it down. It's too easy for someone to pick it up when you turn your head.
Oh, hey, you know, you're just full of good advice. Thanks, McGruff.
You're welcome. Just remember, keep your wallet in a safe place. Never leave your bags or valuables unattended, even for a minute. Mm. Do that and you'll be helping
take a bite out of crime.
You got it. A public service message from me, McGruff, the U.S. Department of Justice, the Crime Prevention Coalition, and the Ad Council.
Dad, can me and Olivia and you take me to the zoo?
Kids need dads when they're babies.
Daddy! Can I tell you a secret? I think there's a monster under my bed.
When they're little, when they're teens, when they're young adults.
Dad, all my friends stay out till midnight.
But sadly, most kids don't have a dad to rely on.
Dad, I met the most amazing person the other day, and I was just wondering, how did you know that Mom was the one?
Because most dads spend less than 10 minutes a day with their kids.
Dad, should I invest in a CD or a mutual fund? What do you think?
Being a dad is real simple. All it takes is time. And it takes a man to be a dad. Call 1-800-790-DADS for free, helpful information. A message from the National Fatherhood Initiative and the Ad Council.
All right. For the guy who faxed me, it was Giant Robot was the name of that robot, or Gigantor, depending on which one you're talking about.
Thanks for the fax from LZ, who told me why I can't get into my own chat rooms.
All right. Nick, thank you very much for coming in.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me. It was fun.
311, everyone, the world's greatest band. Go out and buy every CD they made, and even some that they haven't. Sound System's the name of the latest, and again, if you already have it, get a second one. I want to thank producer Ann for doing a great job all week, and I want to welcome her back to the LoveLine family. It's good to see her smiling face. I also want to thank Danielle for doing a great job, and of course Anderson for doing a great job on the boards.
And Daniel for operating the web more effectively.
That's right. That's right. The package, Daniel Kelson. So, until next time, it's Adam Kroll for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
He's just a dick.
Well, now.
This has been LoveLine. The stuff expressed on LoveLine is not necessarily the stuff of the staff, management, sponsors, or anyone else, including Westwood One Entertainment. LoveLine is produced by Ann Wilkins Ingold. Now, please enjoy these birds.